Well, I have to tell you that I'm honored and humbled by this award. It's really nice to see so many friends and acquaintances and let's admit it, lawyers out there in the audience today. I have to make mention, number one, of the people at my table, my daughter Kathy and my granddaughter Kylie, my wife Kelly, my 40-year secretary and assistant, Tresha Griffiths, and Clive Strong and his wife. Clive was chief of my natural resources division in the AG's office. President Schlimpert, Dean Langan, thank you so much. You know, it's a pleasure to share the program today with Cindy Wilson, who is really a distinguished educator. She's done a wonderful job, she and the other great teachers, in motivating and educating our children with a little greater commitment from the state of Idaho in the way of resources. They would gladly do more. But you know, excellent teachers need receptive students, and I guess that's where I fit in today. I'm not much of a teacher, but I have certainly learned a lot over the years from good teachers, from fine individuals that I've dealt with, and from that thing that they call the school of hard knocks. I guess it's experiential learning. And I'd like to tell you some of the lessons I've learned in those last 50 years. And I say 50 years because I took the Idaho bar, graduated from law school, took the Idaho bar, and became a lawyer 50 years ago in 1967. This year the bar will give me a 50-year pin, I guess, unless something happens. So let me tell you about my first job. After I passed the bar and graduated and all that stuff, I was put to work by an organization with, it was a worldwide organization, I guess you might call it, the United States Army. And they put me in the branch where they put their lawyers. It's called Field Artillery. After a short period of time in Okinawa, I went to the Republic of Vietnam in July of 1978, and I spent the next 407 days there. I wasn't counting, really, but that's what it turned out to be. I was stationed in Tainan Province, which was northwest of what used to be Saigon, along the Cambodian border, and most of my time I spent with South Vietnamese soldiers at the South Vietnamese compound. I lived with the South Vietnamese and worked with them, and they were wonderful people. Many of the people I worked for were refugees in their own country because they had gone south when the country was partitioned in 1954. Their sin was being members of the Catholic Church because that was not permitted in North Vietnam. And a lot of the people could tell you stories about how they had seen relatives persecuted, gunned down on the streets. So these people were refugees in their own right. I also worked with an orphanage that was run by the Cao Dai Church. It's a universalist religion that was located in Tainan City, where I was at. And they had an orphanage. Most of the kids were war victims. Their parents had been killed, and they had no place else to go. So again, they were war victims. And the reason I tell you that is that one of the most important lessons I have ever learned in my life is that war victims are not there because they did anything. They're there because they were brutalized and, they were found with no place to go, and a lot of them had to leave. One of the saddest days in my life, it dang near broke my heart, was in April of 1975. My wife is saying, don't say that, because I always get a little bit choked up, but when I watch those people hanging on the helicopter skids as they were leaving the U.S. Embassy. But that wasn't the worst part. The worst part was in the coming years, when people said, well, those boat people shouldn't be let into the United States. They are going to be trouble. They are going to bring pestilence, disease, and they're going to be infiltrators from the communist country. Well, that wasn't true. They were just people looking for a peaceful place to live. And they were wonderful people. They've been good citizens. And the reason I bring that up is because I hear some of those same voices being raised today. These refugees are horrible. They'll bring disease. They'll bring terror. They'll bring pestilence. You know, we created the conditions for those people to become refugees, and we have a responsibility to open our hearts and give them refuge. We need to be friendly, we need to be helpful, and we need to say, we're here to give you a hand, and God would like us to do that. I learned something else in Vietnam when the miscreants in our battalion learned that I was a lawyer. I was the one they went to for their criminal defense in the court-martial. So I learned, nobody was there to teach me how to do a defense, but I learned that you attack a problem just like you handle a military situation. You find out everything you can. You look at your best case and your worst case, the other side's best case and their worst case. You figure out what your strategy is. You anticipate that there will be obstacles. You figure out how you're going to overcome them. And then you move forward to the very end. And, you know, that served me well in my subsequent legal career. When I went to Washington to work for Senator Jordan, I learned a couple of good lessons there. I had to talk to everybody who came in with a grievance or who had something that they were pushing. And I learned, despite what I thought my outlook on the world was, that a lot of times people who you thought you disagreed with brought in valid points. And what you needed to do was hear them out, find out what their solution was, and recognize that sometimes you're not always right. The other thing I learned, and it was from one of the best people I ever met, Senator Len Jordan, I would go in and say, Senator, here's the issue. Here's what most of our constituents want. I said, I assume you're going to go along. And he says, no, Jim, I don't agree. And he said, you know, you don't always have to be a follower. Sometimes if you know that your constituents are headed in the wrong direction, what you do is you tell them where you stand, you go out and educate them and see if you can bring them along. So that's what a leader does. And I think that there is a great shortage of leadership today. But anyway, it made a big impression on me. When the senator retired, I went back to Jerome and set up a solo law practice there. And I'll guarantee you, I knew nothing about civil law. When the first person left my office with a problem, I got on the phone and I called a lawyer around Jerome there, and he said, here's what you do. I learned something really wonderful about the Idaho legal profession. Everybody cooperates and helps the other. I must have made dozens of phone calls to practically every lawyer in the Magic Valley, and all but one were very helpful. They said, here's what you do. Do you want some forms? Can I help you out? You know, unless they were on the other side. But, you know, it was wonderful. It made me proud of the profession that I had chosen. I learned something else, too, that a lot of times people come in and they say, I've got this problem, but I cannot give you an upfront fee, or I maybe can't give you anything. I don't think anybody ever told me that I should do it. But you know, you look at them and they're honest and genuine people, and you say, okay, hey, look, I can help you, but I'm not going to charge you anything. Now, what I can't condone is when somebody says, well, I did a lot of pro bono work. I sent out a bill and they didn't pay it. No, that's not pro bono. If you're thinking you're going to get paid up front, you're not doing it out of the goodness of your heart. I decided in 1978 that I was going to run for office. George Hansen was in trouble. He'd been convicted of a couple of campaign finance violations, so I threw my hat in the ring 45 days before the primary. Wasn't the smartest thing, partly because I'm a committed introvert. When that first TV camera was shoved in my face, my mouth was as dry as the Gobi Desert, and I thought I was going to faint. I learned that if you are really committed to something and if you really want to reach a goal, you can find a way to do it. It took a while for me to overcome that, but I finally did. And now I can shoot my mouth off at any time, any place, at the drop of a hat, which a lot of people probably are not too happy about. I was elected Attorney General in 1982, and immediately I got to apply the lessons that Senator Jordan had told me about on the issue of leadership. The Supreme Court of the state of Idaho, in its infinite wisdom, had just essentially handed over the Snake River to Idaho Power Company, and the white supremacists up north were flexing their muscles. On the water issue, I teamed up with former Governor John Evans, and we fought the good fight to get the state back in control of the river. And it was really odd because we had half of the Republicans and half of the Democrats in both houses on our side and the other half on the power company's side. And we fought and we fit until we were able to reach a resolution of the issue, which I think has worked out good. But I think the important part is that you had a Republican Attorney General and a Democrat governor who were working side by side, hand in hand, for the greater good of the state. And one of the reasons we prevailed is that we went out and we talked and we educated and we brought the people along with us to the point where we were able to work something out. On the other issue, I got a call from Marilyn Schuller early in 1983, and Marilyn said, "We've got this malicious harassment bill. It has run into a roadblock. The National Rifle Association doesn't like some stuff in it. Can you help?" So we worked out a bill. It was passed by the legislature. And I became really committed to the effort to put the kibosh on the white supremacists, the Aryan Nations. Went to meetings. At the time, there were a lot of people that were reluctant to join in because they didn't know whether it was going to be politically feasible for them to take a stand. But after a couple of years of many people and many organizations of good faith, we were able to get the Aryan Nation shut down. And I have to tell you that if it wasn't for Marilyn Schuller, it wouldn't have happened. Marilyn passed away in February. She had a wonderful memorial ceremony. She was remembered as one of the leading lights for standing up for human rights in the state. And I can tell you that she was a great inspiration to me. When I went back to law practice here, I took some of those lessons with me, but I had by that time some experience to help others. When a lawyer called me and he wanted some help on a case, I gave it to him. When people walked in the door and they didn't have a fee, I found out that the best pay you can get for handling a legal matter is genuine gratitude as opposed to money. So anyway, I get on the court in 2005. I lost a couple of decades there. And you know, you'd think an old dog would quit learning at that point, but I still learned a lesson or two. Chief Justice Jerry Schroeder told me, you need to have some civility on this court. And he says, what you probably shouldn't be doing is criticizing other justices or their reasoning, and just state your own case. And that made an impression on me, and I tried to follow that advice. I probably dissented a little more than other people, But instead of going after them or saying mean things about them, I just wrote what I thought was right and let it stand at that. And I think that was the way to go. So here I am in my 50th year of my legal career, half of it in private practice, half of it in public service. And I have to tell you that, after all these years, I'm really honored and humbled to be selected as a leader in law here at Concordia Law School. When you have people like Steve Trott and Ed Lodge being on the list of those folks, it is really a humbling thing. I've developed a great respect for Concordia Law School because I've dealt with Jody on the pro bono commission. She's a real fire putter outer and, hadn't started too many of her own, but she's really a ball of fire on that group. I've talked to a lot of Concordia students who've applied for clerkships. They are as good as any applicants that I've gotten. I hired two. One of them is still working on the court. So I think you've got a good school. As to my merits for this award, I have to admit that I'm just merely a composite of everybody who has taught me over these years, good teachers, good role models, a little bit of experience learning. And so all of those people who have contributed to who I am, I think I have to give a great deal of thanks to, and I give some thanks to the law school too. I have to say that you haven't heard the last of me. I have big plans. I've got books to write, a refugee pro bono program to get going. I have opinions to share in the public arena, and other stuff. 2 weeks after I retired, I was told that I had a major health problem. But do you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go back to one of those very first lessons I learned. I'm going to learn everything about it. I'm going to overcome any obstacles in the way. And with the help of a good friend of mine, I'm going to persist to the very end. Thank you.
Dr. Schlimpert, Dean Langen, I'm going to just say Dean Seilig because I got confused on what you are now. Chief Justice Jones, and your family, and guests, my heart is literally so full right now. I have watched your career over the course of my life. I just want to be like you. I guess everybody does. May I just introduce a few of my honored guests tonight? I have a former student who's now at Boise State. He's a wonderful activist. Jackson, will you please stand up and just wave to everybody? Jackson Bidner. Thank you. Also at this table, and you can hold your applause for just a moment. I have a few guests I want to take time to introduce. My dear friend, my traveling companion, all of those places you heard that I was able to go, this was my roommate. Former teacher, longtime educator, my mentor and dear friend, Cynthia Jenkins, at the back table there. My dear friends who have been through all the experience you're going to hear about in just a moment with me, Mike and Lisa Schlagenhoff. And up in the front here, I'm so happy to have my principal, Sandy Winters, here. I think everyone knows that a good leader at the top not only makes everybody happy, but allows special things to happen. And that's what I have at Capitol and in the Boise District. Amazing. I also have here my dear mother. If there's ever an example of servant leadership, she is it. The countless cakes and rolls and dinners that were provided to others in our home, the many boards that she served on with my father, the countless hours of community service, never asking anything in return. My role model, my mother, I'm glad you're here. I also have my son and daughter-in-law who are so dear to my heart. I'm so proud of the work they're doing. My son is an Arab linguist, waiting for an assignment back on the East Coast. But while he's here, he's helping refugee families. And I'm so proud of the work he's doing. My most honored guest, nearly, my grandson Locke, named after political philosopher, yes, John Locke. All my children are named after presidents, and now we're starting on philosophers. May we all be like him, as the other morning when he prayed on the food, he just asked that everyone could be kind to one another. I love you, Locke. I'm glad you're here. My number one fan, my best friend, my partner in everything, who's made me better just by living his life, my husband, Wayne Wilson. I'm glad you're here. I prepared another speech that I threw away a couple of nights ago. And I'm glad I did. It was very boring. But I'm listening to Justice Jones' speech, and I'm thinking a lot about this audience, and I hope that what I've prepared can be meaningful for you. I have some dear friends also in the audience tonight. Justice Horton, Judd Lansing, Jody, Carrie, people with whom I've served on so many committees and so much work with youth in government. I'm glad you're here, and I hope that all of you tonight can benefit from something that I can share with you. My family homesteaded back in 1887 in a small area of southeastern Idaho, just east of Preston. In fact, there was a spring coming down off the mountain, and that's where we get the name of our farm, Spring Creek Farm. Everybody calls it Little Egypt because it was fertile soil. Now, rumor has it that my great-great-great-grandfather, when he settled there, he really thought he was in Utah. But when they did the survey, they're about 7 miles north, and that's how I became an Idahoan. At about that same time, my husband's family was settling, homesteading, on the Wiyite Prairie of north central Idaho, where Sacagawea met Lewis and Clark and aided them with the camas root and the salmon from the Clearwater River. I had a great childhood, and in my senior year of high school, a local neighbor who was serving in the Idaho legislature, Angus Condi, he came to me and he said, "Would you be interested in serving as a page in the Idaho legislature?" Well, I was always one to take an opportunity, but I was pretty active in high school. And I didn't want to leave my friends for 6 weeks. I didn't know if I could do that. You know, studies, yeah, that's okay, but friends, that would be difficult. So I thought about it for a while and then said, okay, I'll do it. That changed my life. I came to Boise in the spring of 1976. And maybe some of you will remember these names of folks in the legislature. Speaker of the House, Alan Larson from southeastern Idaho. Beautiful, dark-haired minority leader, Patricia McDermott. Democratic Governor Cecil Andrus, who took all of us pages out to lunch one day. Oh, I was in my glory. I knew somebody in every legislative district of this state. I remember telling my father, "Dad, don't worry. If I break down anywhere in the state, I have a friend. I can call somebody." That was a great time. I loved it. And honestly, from that point on in my life, I knew I wanted to do something with government and politics. As you heard, I graduated from Boise State University. With a degree in political science, I too was the first in my family to graduate from college. I honestly, my mother will tell you, we don't know how I got through, because I remember taking food from the freezer. We ate a lot of potatoes so many different ways. And I didn't have a student loan. I feel bad for the young people today who, just to get a bachelor's degree, it's so sad, but in those days it was only about $670 a semester. I'm very fortunate. My husband and I moved to a little town named Pierce, Idaho, up in north central Idaho after graduation. And while I was there, the local school there, it was a K-8 school, and they had a teacher who was going on maternity leave, and they were hoping to get a substitute for her. Now, they knew that I did not have a teaching degree, but I had a bachelor's degree, and that would do. So because I was probably the only one in town that wasn't working that had a degree, they took me on. I loved that school, Pierce School. In fact, a couple of years later, in 1986, our little school won the Presidential Award for Excellence in Education. I can still see the picture with the banner in front of us as the entire staff stood there, so proud of the work we were doing. That was a special time. I was able to get on with the school because they said, if you'll go back and get your teaching certificate, we'll hire you. So I did that. And that's where I began my career in education, a career that has now spanned 32 years. In those days, I'm a little embarrassed to say it, but we used to give kids spankings. We called them a hack. And Mr. Anthony, the principal, would call a witness down to the office to watch as he gave students this punishment. So on numerous occasions, I was called out. I really didn't think anything of it at the time, but now that I'm telling you, it just doesn't seem right. But I remember one time in particular being called down to the office because Chris, cute little sixth grader, but he had this penchant for mischief. And he was in trouble again, and Mr. Anthony would give him a hack. So I got called in, and I stood there in the office, and Mr. Anthony was trying to talk to Chris about what he'd done wrong, and Chris is just doing everything he can to try to get out of the situation. And Mr. Anthony finally said to Chris, okay, bend over and let's get this over with. And Chris kind of did this. And Mr. Anthony said, no, Chris, bend over and grab your ankles. Let's get this over with. So Chris kind of moved his hands down to his knees. A third time, Mr. Anthony asked Chris to bend over and get this over with. Chris just wasn't doing it. And exasperated, Mr. Anthony said to Chris, Chris, bend over and take your medicine. And little Chris looked up and said, I gotta take medicine too? I am glad we don't go through that anymore, although Miss Winters may like that idea of punishment. But I'm glad that we don't do that anymore. We've come a long ways in 32 years. However, I've been thinking a lot about that phrase, take your medicine. I've been thinking about how taking the medicine in my own life, has transformed me. And if you don't mind, I'd like to share a couple of personal experiences with you. As I mentioned, I was raised by a wonderful family, lovely little community, all the business leaders I knew. I worked at my grandma's cafe in town, knew everybody, had this great life. 2 years into my college education, I was assaulted and became pregnant. I couldn't believe this was happening to me. How would I recover from this? It was 1979. You didn't go to police, you didn't go to anybody. It took months for me to tell my parents. And I did what most girls did at that time. I went away to have a child and have it placed for adoption. I flew to Hawaii, and I lived in a stranger's home until I had the child, and she was adopted, and then I came back to continue my life. While I was there, I felt so alone. I reached deep inside of myself and thought, I can do this. I can do hard things. I thought that if I could just get through this, I could be a better person. If I could just take the medicine and move on, I could be made healthy. That experience led to me being able to take the medicine so many other times in my life and move on. Single parent for 7 years, struggling on a teacher's salary. The local cafeteria worker would bring me food. It's illegal, by the way. And she would put it in my car. Later, I had my second son, contracted RSV, and at only 1 month old, he spent a week in a hospital tent. I couldn't even bring him out, except for a quick feeding, and I had to put him back in. But he made it. That was a hard time. 21 years ago last month, our house in Orofino was destroyed in a flood. The flood of 96. Kind of reminds me of... And at that time, I thought again how I needed to take the medicine and be made stronger and better because of that experience. All of these experiences were a different type of medicine, but all of them healed me. They made me stronger. They made me healthier. They made me better. About 10 years ago, my dear friend Cynthia and I were traveling with a group of 20 educators throughout China. We went into schools and met students and teachers and were having this most wonderful experience of education and learning and thinking about lessons we would come back and create for Idaho school children. Well, the last night we were there, we decided that because we are the self-appointed social directors, we would hold a party. And for just a few dollars, we could go down the street and get flowers to fill this whole room. And so that's what we did. We went down and we got all of these flowers and we filled the room and we invited all of our friends to come up for this party. And we partied. It was fun. We had a good time. We had to leave. I think we had to leave our suitcases out in the hall because they would pick them up. We had to leave so early in the morning. Next morning, on our way to the airport, I realized my travel documents were gone. I could not find my passport, my visa, my airline ticket. We looked and looked through everything. We called the hotel where we'd stayed. We went through everything. We went out to the airport, and I watched as the 20 other members of my delegation filed off up the ramp to the flight, which I could not board. Our guide was flying back to Germany. He had a few extra minutes, so he sat there with me, and Cynthia can imitate this because she knows Garrett. He looked at me and he said, "Cindy, Cindy, Cindy." I knew I was in trouble. I was scared. He left, and I was alone again. I realized I did not know anybody in the city of Shanghai, 18 million. Not only that, I didn't know anybody in the country of China. I didn't know anybody on the continent of Asia. I felt alone. It was time for me to take a new medicine, to experience a new trial, to become stronger and better from this experience. Throughout all of these experiences, I've also gained a tremendous faith, which has carried me as well. And I called on that at that time. Miraculously, because of the strength I had and the wits about me because of other things that had happened where I had taken my medicine, I was able to focus on how I would get out of this communist country by myself. I'll tell you right now, the consulate was no help. But through all kinds of other miracles, it was only about 24 hours that I worked hard on filling out the police report, making a request through my husband to try to get this new passport sent and all of these different things. And I arrived back in Boise a day and a half late. Thank you. Thank you. And my husband deserves a lot of credit for the work he did here for that. The point I'm trying to make is, I'm not unique in these experiences and trials. We all have them. I think of you. We can be made stronger. We can be made better when we take the medicine, when we experience the trials that come to us. And why does that matter? Because in becoming better ourselves, we have more to offer others. We then become the kind of servant leaders that we want to be. Because we can offer our own advice, our own experiences, our own knowledge of what we've gained. And I believe it's all part of this big round circle. Someone gave to us, we give back to them, and through that, we all take the medicine, and we all become healed, and we all become better, and we all find joy. There is a pastor that ministers to the New England Patriots. You might have heard of them. Pretty successful football team. I found this quote really interesting. His name is Jack Easterby, and here's what he said, and I honestly want this for my life mantra. I hope that you'll enjoy it too. Your legacy is not what people remember about you. It is what people will do differently because they met you. Thank you.